All right, so I don't think you necessarily need to write this down. You just need to know these concepts. In a one-variable equation, when I solve this, I get one solution. Okay, just focus. Yeah. When I solve this, I get one solution. If you have an equation like this, what's different about it? Ben?
It's two-dimensional.
Okay.
I learned that in 7th grade. I don't know.
Okay, what else is different about it? David?
It's squared.
No. It's squared. Squared means you may have two answers. Two-dimensional, two answers. Okay? It has two dimensions. And yes, that X is exactly, if I were making a tile of it, and this is an X, he said it's two-dimensional. If that's an X, the X squared looks like this, X times X. And that gives you X squared. So it is two-dimensional because it's a measure of X by X. And this is just a measure of X. Okay, when you have an X squared term, we call that a quadratic. You will get two solutions most of the time. Most of the time, you'll get two solutions. But if x squared equals 0, there is only one solution. Okay? And there's other situations, but... All right, next. When you have two variables, you basically have... We have a number of answers, right? 1 plus 4 makes that true. What else makes that statement true?
2 plus 4. I mean, 2 plus 3.
2 plus 3. How about 3 plus 2? How about 4 plus 1? How about negatives? All of these make it true. We have fractions. You know, 4.5 plus 1/2 makes 5. Or... 1/2 plus 4.5 makes 5. Plus I have negatives, right? I could say negative 1/2 plus five and a half would give us 5. And yeah, give us 5. So, you know, there's a number of solutions to this. Now these solutions that fit in, there's an X and a Y, and when they call it an X, it's the first part of the ordered pair. It's the first part of this. That's your X. So when they give you an X, it's right here. When they give you a Y, it's always the second number in the ordered pair. And so this becomes 1, 4, 2, 3, 4, 1, 5, 0, 7, -2, and 1/2, 4.5. These are ordered pairs. Okay, questions about that? Clear, unclear? Clear, thumbs up. Unclear, thumbs down. Okay, Rosie, what part's unclear? Okay, what it is I'm choosing, so she's saying, what was, just the part that's unclear is how, what does the 1, 4 have to do with each other? I'm choosing two possible values to fit in here to make that a true statement. So, if I make my X 1, what does my Y have to be? It has to be 4. But if I make my Y, my X 2, what does my Y have to be?
Okay,
I'm getting it from this equation. And then those two values that I used, the 1 and the 4, that's an ordered pair to plot on a line. Does that make more sense?
Yeah.
Are there other people that have more questions that are unclear? Yes?
I'm just unclear how you got that equation to get the solution.
The equation was given. We're going to be given an equation with two variables, and you're going to have to make it a true statement. And it's like, that equation's like a number machine. You plug numbers in, and you get a number out. And whatever you plug in and whatever you get out is a point on a line. Okay? Does that explanation clear it up a bit? Sarkis.
Is there, whenever we get these questions, is there like a number, is there like a certain number of solutions we have to show?
We'll get there. Hold on. Just hold off. All right. So now we're going to move on to this is the first part of your homework. Oh, and again, this is, you can also put your ordered pairs in an XY table. This is called a table. Here's the ordered pairs. Here it's listed as X equals and Y equals. There's your ordered pair. You can put it into a table like that. Different ways to show the information. So we're given this equation. Randomly given this equation. X plus Y equals negative 5. What they want to know is determine whether the ordered pair is a solution to the given equation. So all we have to do for this is to substitute in. Who was I just talking to over here? Rosie. Where would I substitute the 8 for? For the X. And where does the 3 get substituted in? Okay, and so I get 8 plus 3, that's, what is that? Okay, so that's 11. Is that equal to negative 5?
No.
So you would write not a solution, or no, not a solution, or no. And what that's meaning is, on the graph, I didn't graph it yet because we're not really doing it. On the graph, the line's going to kind of look like this. This point, 8, 3, is not going to be on that line. That's what that means. Do you understand that? When they say it's not a solution, it's not a point on the line. So let's try one more. Yes?
I was just wondering about why would you put 8 for X and 3 for Y? Why not 3 for X and...
Because look at it. It's in an ordered pair. Oh. And in this, anytime you have this... Anytime you have this, the first one is always considered X. The second one is always considered Y. It's universal. That's why if it's not an ordered pair, okay, and you're talking about, like, let's say we're doing a perimeter problem and you want the width and the length, you don't put it in parentheses like this. You don't say the width is 2 and the length is 3. Because this implies it's an ordered pair, the parentheses. If you were doing that, if you were talking about width and length, then you would put it like this. Do you understand? But as soon as you put it into these parentheses, it's assumed it's an ordered pair. And that the X is first and the Y is second. Yes, Ben. No, not at this point. You have to read the directions. In every part, it's going to tell you if they want you to create a table and graph, or do they just want you to create a table of solutions, or do they want you to just find the solution to this? When they give you one point, they probably don't want you to graph it. They want you to just figure out if this is a solution to the equation. You could write no. Okay, so let's try the next one. Which one gets substituted where? Rogelio.
12 gets substituted for the x.
Good, so it's going to read?
12 equals 8 minus 4.
Good, close. 12 equals 8 minus negative 4. Okay, I don't want you doing anything in your head. Don't hold those negatives in your head. That's where we make mistakes. We make too many mistakes holding negatives in our hair. Take the time to write it down. It's worth you not missing that question. Now, you can simplify. Negative, negative is really, that really means the 4 is positive. Okay, and so that ends up equaling 12 is equal to 12. Yes, it's a solution. I would finish it all the way out. I want to see the numbers match or the numbers not match. I want you to finish that out. Sarkis.
Is there something shorter with your life instead of it's not a solution?
Yes and no. Oh. I'll take yes and no.
Okay.
Yes, solution. No, not a solution. All right, number, yes.
Number 1, for example?
I want you to finish it out.
So you want us to add it up at the end?
Yeah. I want you to prove to me that 11, this side is not equal to this side.
Okay.
So that is not a solution to the equation. Okay, now you guys do 3 and 4. Go. Okay, so now check your work. Oops. And negative 2 does not equal 6. Sorry, I jumped ahead without putting the recording on. So this is not a solution. All right. We can do this. I'm going to jump down. They're going to give you it like number 1. You just substitute it in. And tell me, is this a solution?
Yes.
Okay. Is this a solution?
No.
Is this a solution?
Yes, it is.
That's where you get yourself in trouble, holding negatives in your head. This is negative 9, positive 14. That does make positive 5. Now, this is the one I really wanted you to see. Now, be careful with this, because a lot of people, I find, do this. 3 1/2. That's not the same as 3 times 1/2. Remember, this becomes 3 over 1 times 1 over 2. What does that simplify to?
3 over 2.
3 over 2 minus, actually it's a plus. I'm going to turn that into a common fraction. I mean, improper. It's 7 over 2 equals 5. And all those numbers you're blurting out are not helping because you're storing information in your head and they're not accurate. Take the time to write it out. So 3, positive 3 and positive 7, Oscar, are?
10.
So 10 over 2, is that 4?
No.
Okay, so take the time to write it down. Is that a solution?
No.
Yes.
Yes, it is, because that's 5 equals 5. Now, the one thing I want you to remember is, notice we did this with a fraction. So there are, I'm going to draw the whole picture for you. We said with two variables there are an infinite amount of solutions. All right, so this is a two variable equation. The big question is here, hopefully you learned a little bit about this in 7th grade. How would I begin to graph this? What would I begin to do when it says, complete the chart and graph? Michael.
Oh, I would make the XY table and then start with 1, 2, 3, and 4.
Okay, very good. I would start with something different. Anybody in here that was my student last year? No, I don't have any of my old students. I don't think I had you.
Yeah, you did.
Not when we were in this chapter.
Mm-hmm.
And he switched out. Okay, what else would you start with, Luke?
What about isolating one variable so you can see what it
happens?
Oh, I don't know, I'm sorry.
No, because I want, well, I mean, your one variable is isolated, the y. Okay, yes.
I would start by plotting the y, the -3.
No, I would do, I'm going to tell you, I'm not going to make it a guessing game because we don't have time. I'm going to start with, I want a negative value, I want a 0, and I want a positive value. Now, if my numbers, those are the choices. So when you're choosing your x, when you choose this right here, it's your choice. You might not choose the same numbers that I do, but I'm going to tell you why I choose those. I like to keep it close so that I can graph it. Because if you choose big numbers, it might be off the graph. It exists because this line goes on and on and on forever, and it might end up somewhere up here in space. So I keep it close to 0. So I take, if it's a whole number, I take -1, 0, +1. Just keep it close to 0. So he was right, he chose, but is he going to be wrong because he chooses 1, 2, 3, 4?
No.
Just some of those points might not end up on the line that you're looking at. It might be the point down here if you continue that line on. So I'm going to choose, now you'll see my graph chooses a lot different. They choose a lot. 2 points in math determine a line. That's the rule. But I'm going to say 3. I want you to do 3. Okay? I want you to do 3 because it makes your line more accurate the further the 2 points are apart when you draw them. Yes?
Do we have to have a -0 and +1?
I do. I want a negative value, a 0 value, and a positive value. Yes?
Since -3 is first, can you start off by
No, I start off plotting with, I substitute that in. Now, in seventh grade, I do this. I don't do this in algebra. We use the XY table. I do it kind of like this. I build the table like this. And I really kind of get rid of that, and I make it 2x minus 3 equals the y. Okay? And I do that because it gives the kids a place to visually see what's going on. So I'm taking the x and I have to substitute it with -3. 2 times -3 is what? Rogelio.
-6 minus 3.
Is? -9. Right? -6 minus 3. Add them because they're both the same. Okay? So I kind of do that. You don't have to. Look at how my table does it on the PowerPoint. They kind of do a mixture right here. And that's your y, -9. Next one, what's the point going to be? Oscar.
-7.
-4. 2 times -2 is? And -3 is?
-7.
-4, -3. Good. Sorry. Next one. Now notice, they're getting rid of that in between and they're starting to do it in their head. Most of my kids in eighth grade will just do the XY table, don't need to do this. Because they spent a year in my class, well, not a year, but they spent seventh grade, you know, basically writing it all down and they've kind of learned how to deal with it. If you need to write that, write it. If you don't, then okay. So now I'm going to have 2 times 0. 2 times 0 is what?
Zero.
Minus 3 is?
-3.
So the next one's going to be -3. Okay. 2 times 1.
Zero.
Sorry, it's taking a long. And 2 times 2 is 4, minus 3 is 1. Okay, next one. Now, Notice what did I say to you? How many points do you need?
Three.
Three. Okay. Well, actually, let's hold on. Let's go. Let's plot these points. So the first one is the first plot point you have is -3, -3, -9. 1, 2, 3, then down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Do you see how that's off the chart?
Yeah.
That's why I stay close to zero. I always stay close to zero. So on my graphs, I pick these three. I pick these three to start with. Is it wrong if you picked 1, 2, 3?
No.
No. But I take a negative, a positive, and a zero. Yes?
Will any of our graphs, will they be any bigger than this, or are they just going to be the same size as this?
Well, you know, you're going to have to. So that, wait, let's go on. Let's go back. Wait. Let me answer that afterwards. So the next point is to plot all these points. -3, -9 is not on it. -2, -7, that's not on it either. But -1, -5, that is on it. I start at the origin, I go, remember this is always my across movement. So I go back 1, down 5. Across 0, down 3. Across 1, down 1. Across 2. Now, what if my x is 7/2? Yes. Perfect. That's exactly what he's doing. He's making sense of that number. And that number, 7 over 2, is really 3 and?
1 over 2.
Yeah, 3.5. He's turning that into a mixed number. That's the same thing. Now, if x, I'm going to use the equation. Y equals 2 times 7 over 2. Minus 3. Okay? So what does that become? -3. So that becomes y equals 7 minus 3, which is 4. Y equals 4. So in this case, my y is going to be 4. I can use fractions. Okay, so now I'm moving across. What did we say this was really?
3.5. 3.5.
I start at my origin. 1, 2, 3.5, and then move up 1, 2, 3, 4. And I plot the point. Now I have to take a ruler, connect the last dot to the first dot and run it through. Run the arrow all the way through. Okay, it is on the line. Those fractions, notice these are all whole numbers. They're right where the boxes meet. But the fractions are all in here and in here and in between the corners. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So there are an unlimited, and if I continue this line forever and ever in space, there's an infinite amount of points. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Since like on the test and our homework, we would only have to do to find 3 points.
Yeah, you don't have to do all this. You choose your three. Keep it close to zero. If it's a whole number, I'd use +1, -1, and 0. And I would try and do it in a row. Meaning -1, 0, 1. Don't do -1, 1, 0. Hold on. This line represents
2.
Y equals 2x minus 3. Okay? That is the line for any point. on 2x minus 3. Okay? Now, oh, I have so much more to do. What happens if my y is not alone? I have to get it alone. So what do I need to do? Yes. No, if I divide 2x on both sides, I'm going to end up with, look. Okay, divide by 2. I'm going to end up with x plus y over 2 equals 5 over 2. That didn't help me. I need to get the y alone. It's always getting the y alone. So, Rogelio. Subtract the 2x. That makes it become 0. And now I've got y equals negative 2x. And what kind of 5? A positive 5. Now I can use that and set it up in a table. Now I can use that and set it up in a table. Shh. Okay, what would I do first in the next one? Shh. What would I do first in the next one? Rogelio.
To get y removed.
Yep. Step one.
Add x, then divide by 2.
Add x to both sides. And why am I writing the x first? Do you remember? Rogelio? X always goes first in slope-intercept form. I'm setting you up for later. Slope-intercept form. And now, how do I get rid of that 2 next to the y? Somebody else, Kachik. Divide all parts by 2. That means the y is divided by 2. I'm going to write it like this. Watch. Divide all terms by 2. So this is divided by 2, this is divided by 2, and this is divided by 2. Now you can see I'm left with y equals, what's the coefficient of x?
One.
Who keeps doing that?
Paul.
Okay. Shh. Y equals 1 over 2x, and this is minus 2. Does that make sense? Do you understand how that really had a 1? The coefficient of this is really 1/2. David?
We could, in a regular equation, just put x over 2, but since we have to graph x, is that why we put
1/2
times x?
Yeah, you're going to have to, well, I guess you could keep it as x over 2, but eventually we're going to need the slope. So, in this type of situation, you're going to keep doing that. This is how it's really applied. You get an equation like this. Step one, what do I have to do? Luke? What's my goal?
Get y alone.
Subtract 3x. I'm left with this. Divide both sides by 2. I get y equals negative 3x over 2 plus 4 over 2.
So we're going to have to graph all that?
And then, that then becomes the equation that you pick your three values for. What values? Now, in this case, I have a fraction in it. Anytime you have a fraction, the numbers you're picking here should be a multiple of the denominator. But keep it close to 0. I want a positive, a negative, and a 0.
Negative 2.
Negative 2.
Zero.
Perfect. Now they're picking a whole bunch of them. But I only need these 3. So as I do that, when x, and you can kind of write it in. If you want to do that middle part for your table, so when x is negative 2, negative 3 over 2 times negative 2 plus 2. Notice these are going to cross cancel. And I'm left with a negative 1. So that really becomes 3 plus 2, and that makes 5. So it's negative 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is going to be easy because when x is 0, my y will be 2. Are you with me?
No.
When I substitute the 0 in, Sarkis, when I substitute that 0 here, anything times 0 makes it 0. 0 plus 2 is 2. 0 across 1, 2. And then I'm going to do, what's the next one? Positive 2. I can cross cancel. That becomes negative 3 plus 2. So what's my answer going to be? So the answer is 2 across, 1, 2, down 1. And now when you're doing your lines, I don't want to see any baby lines. I want it to go from the top all the way through. Keep running it through. And I want you to have arrows on each of them. Sorry, I can't do the arrows right now. Hold on. Shh. Because this means the line goes on and on forever. All right, questions? I got to do one more thing. Wait, oh, let me get to one more thing and then I'll take them. Shh. I got to erase it. Okay, if I have... Okay, let's just say I have this equation. Pretend this isn't here. Okay, the equation is x equals 2. That means no matter what, x is 2. X is a constant. And I choose the y. Okay, so I'm going to pick any three values. Negative 1, 0, 1. And then I plot my points. 1, 2, down 1. 1, 2, 0. 1, 2, up 1. And I draw the line. Always use a straight edge. Do not give me sloppy lines. Label your x and y axes. Okay. Now, if I had an equation like this, y equals 1. Shh. What's the constant here?
1.
What? What's 1? When y is constant, I put it all in for 1, and you choose.
0, 1, negative 1. 8.
Okay, so x is 1. Shh.
Teachers, we're doing a quick check on the bells. Please continue into nutrition. We're doing a quick check of the emergency bells. Thank you.
Okay, so y is 0, 1, 1, whoop, 0 across 1, 1, 1. Sorry, this one is... And the last one is negative 1. There's the line. All right, so anyways, if I get y equals 1, this time the constant is going to be y. Y is always going to be 1. And I choose my x's, and then I plot it out. And these kinds of equations are going to be... So there it is. These kinds of equations, y equals or x equals one value, is always going to be a horizontal or a vertical line. All right. So that's the end of the lesson. If you want to try the next one, put your recording on pause, get the y all alone, find the ordered pairs, pick 3 points. Again, 3 points, close to 0. And because in this case, my denominator is a 3, I have to pick a multiple of 3. Negative 3, 0, positive 3. And then plot it. Remember to follow your line all the way through. Make sure there are arrows on both ends. And that's the end of the recording.